Hey everyone, thanks for joining me on a Sunday evening or whenever you happen to be tuning into the broadcast. Anytime is a great time to get into God's Word together. And tonight I thought we would have just a little fireside chat. Now, I know there's no fire going right now, but there will be in just a few minutes. I always look forward at the end of the season when it seems like the time for an inside fire has passed. It's mid-May right now, but just to having one more fire. And so tonight I thought I would share that with you and use it to illustrate some principles from God's Word about fire. Now, God's Word often uses fire as an analogy of God's work or even to describe God Himself, but also to describe what He wants to do in and through our lives. And just as I mentioned, wanting to have that one more fire when I haven't had one for a while, I think a lot of times we feel that way spiritually when it seems that we haven't experienced a powerful move of God in quite some time, or maybe when our own lives and our passion for God seems to have cooled off, and we talk about revival sometimes in terms of asking God to send the fire. And I think now as much as ever, with all the tension and turmoil in our society and the ungodliness that's rampant in our culture, that we want to see just one more powerful move of God sweep across our nation and begin to burn white hot in people's lives. And many of us have heard about things like that in our history, but never have experienced such a thing for ourselves. And so we long for God just once again to ignite His passion in our generation. But how does that happen? How does the fire get going? How does it ignite? How do we keep it going? And what are some of the things that can put the fire out? Those are a few of the things that I want to talk about tonight in the time that we have together. Now, in order to have a fireside chat, we need to have a fire. So let's get it going. You know, we can talk about revival or passion or the fire of God, but unless something ignites, there's not going to be a fire. And I know sometimes our lives can probably feel a little bit like this fireplace without flames. So what does it really take to get something going? Well, a lot of times, maybe not quite as much as we think. I know when I go to start a fire, I've got my pile of logs here, but it's usually not very efficient just to try to light one of these. But if I take this small pile of kindling or twigs, which may not seem like much compared to those logs, but it sure ignites a lot easier. Or maybe just this small twisted piece of paper. Or sometimes I'll use a little piece of what's called fatwood. Now, it doesn't seem very fat, but this thing is saturated with natural resins and oils that will stay lit until a fire really gets going. Now, on their own, none of these things may not seem like much. And I know a lot of times our individual lives can probably feel a lot like these small, fragile twigs or like these plain white pieces of paper. But if we allow God to ignite our lives, He can use us to start a raging fire. If our lives are saturated with His Word and the power of His Spirit, then He can ignite a powerful flame of revival in the people and situations around us that burns long after the little stuff is burned up. You know, we can talk about wanting to see revival sweep through our church, our community, our culture, but that fire has to start in the same way as any fire, with a small flame igniting a small substance. And that small flammable substance is our lives. You see, God created us to contain His presence. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 16 describes our lives and bodies as temples of the Holy Spirit. And the Word also describes God's Spirit as fire. In Matthew chapter 3, 11, John the Baptist described Jesus as one who would baptize people with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Hebrews chapter 12, 29 describes God Himself as a consuming fire. And in Luke chapter 12, verse 49, Jesus said that He came to bring fire on the earth. Now, there are a lot of implications to that passage, but as much as anything, it includes what He wants to do in and through us. So essentially, like this fireplace, we were built by God to contain His fire, to burn bright with His power and presence so that everyone around us can see and experience that power through us. And perhaps we can help ignite within them a desire for God as well. You may have heard this before. I'm not sure who first said it, but if we're going to pray for revival, not just to ask God send revival in our church or send revival in our nation, but essentially to draw a circle and then to step inside that circle and to pray, God, send revival within this circle. light a fire in my life and let it burn so intensely that it spreads to everyone around me. But how does a fire like that get going in our lives? Well, it all starts with a small flame. And that flame is like God's Holy Spirit. You know, Jesus promised after he returned to heaven that he would send the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit came on his followers on the day of Pentecost, it said that it settled on each of them like tongues of fire. And they began to speak the word of God with boldness. That was the effect of the fire. That's how it started in the New Testament. And man, did it spread fast. Not only on that day, but to this day, the fire is still going. And that little flame is like the Holy Spirit. He is the source of God's fire. And in order for the Spirit's fire to catch on in our lives, we need to first come in close contact with that source. It has to touch our lives directly. So that's the first way a fire starts. Direct exposure, coming in contact with the source. We've got to be in close contact with Jesus himself. Now, I'm not just talking about our first encounter, but on an ongoing basis, being with Jesus, living in his presence. Now, the Bible says that he's always near, but in James chapter 4:8, he still tells us, draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. You know, God initiated the opportunity for us to have a relationship with him, but he never imposes that on us. He also wants us to take initiative in keeping our lives in direct contact with his fire, not just as a matter of starting our relationship, but as an ongoing daily discipline, coming near to him through those times in his word and prayer, because there's no substitute for those simple disciplines. Those are the ways that he's chosen to reveal himself and his purposes to us. And if we want those purposes to consume our lives and begin to lay hold in the circumstances around us, then it's got to start with his people spending time in God's word and communicating with him through times of prayer. Because just like any other relationship, it's not going to grow or thrive or burn with passion apart from that constant communication. And if we want our lives to burn with God's passion and power and purpose, then we need to stay in direct contact with his source of fire. But you know, another way we can start a fire is with friction. Like when somebody strikes a match, or when a Boy Scout rubs two sticks together, or even when I flick this lighter, there's a tiny mechanism inside that makes just the slightest bit of friction, causes a spark, and ignites the fuel inside. And it can be that way with our spiritual lives too, when at times we might need a little more tension, or maybe I should say more intensity in our walk with God. Some friction, not in the sense of conflict, but understanding that in order to get that fire going, it may not always be comfortable at times. We talk about getting out of our comfort zone because that's how our faith grows and fire ignites. And sometimes that's a bit of a battle with our own human nature. But if we try to avoid that inner tension at all costs, it's going to keep our lives from burning brighter for Christ, because growing in a relationship with God and finding fulfillment in his purposes, that's not going to happen if we always take the easy route or bail out when times get tense or troubling, or when we're going through a spiritual testing. 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 6 and 7 says that the testing of our faith develops patience and refines our character. And being tried by fire will remove impurities from our lives so our faith can be refined like gold. And that's not going to be an easy or a pleasant process, but it's one that we can't shy away from, because instead we need to take those experiences that God brings them through and learn from them. When it would be easier just to bail out, we need to let God stretch us and refine us and bring us closer to himself, because the enemy of our soul would like to drive us further from God and isolate us from him and tell us we're not worthy or spiritual enough. But those are the times we need to get closer than ever to God so he can reignite that fire in our lives. Now, that's just a couple simple ways that we get a fire going. But once it is going, how do we keep it going? And that's the second point I want to make. How do we keep the fire going? Well, first of all, we've got to continually feed and fuel it. Whether it's a large fire like this or a little one like this, if we don't have any fuel or don't keep the fuel replenished, the fire is eventually going to die out. And I think that's what happens a lot of times in our spiritual lives when we feel dry and hard and cold, is we haven't replenished the fuel. If you drive a car, it's got an internal combustion engine where the spark ignites the fuel, and and you don't stop to gas up, eventually you're going to be stuck. And if I want to keep a nice fire going all night, I've got to put a little fuel on it. So what is that fuel for our spiritual lives? Well, we kind of talked about these things already. The first thing is simply God's Word. Psalm 119 is the longest chapter in the Bible, and it talks primarily about the power and benefits of God's Word. And it starts out by saying that the Word helps us avoid sin and to keep our way pure. Joshua 1:8 says that living by the Word helps us achieve true success. And John 14:6 says it gives the Holy Spirit something to remind us of when we need that Word in the tip of our mind. And Ephesians 6:8 talks about that Word being a weapon against Satan's lies and attacks. And 1 Peter 3:15 says that it will help us share with others the reason for the hope that we have. So our life and purpose for God must be fueled by time in His Word. But along with that, we need to be people of prayer. We've already talked about how vital that is, but the best example and proof of the power of prayer is in the life of Jesus Himself. And we see that His disciples, who were constantly with Him and saw the effectiveness of His teaching and witnessed His power firsthand, and they wanted that same power and purpose to be evident in their lives. They didn't say, "Lord, teach us how to communicate effectively," or "teach us how to do miracles." No, they said, "Lord, teach us to pray," because they recognized that that was the source and the reason behind His powerful ministry. In fact, Jesus Himself in John chapter 5, verses 19 and 30, acknowledges Himself that as a human, He could do nothing apart from what He had seen or heard from His Father. And if Jesus needed that kind of refueling in His life, how much more do we need it in order to be effective for Him? Now, in addition to that personal time in prayer and God's Word, the third thing we can do to keep that flame fueled is through worship. And that means both personally and as a church. In Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, it talks about our lives being living sacrifices, which is our spiritual act of worship. And that image of sacrifice depicts something that is consumed by a fire. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15, it also talks about a sacrifice of praise, which means more than just participating in a church worship service, because that's not really any big sacrifice. The time when it becomes one is when we step outside of there and we live lives that truly honor and exalt God in everything that we do. Now, that doesn't mean we neglect time together, because that's also one of the ways that God uses to inspire and to fuel our fire, is when we're worshiping alongside fellow believers. And that's the fourth aspect of how we fuel that fire, is through fellowship or community, because God never intended for us to do this alone. He puts us together so we can grow and serve one another and stay connected both to God and each other. That's why He established the church. In fact, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25 tells us not to neglect those times of gathering together, because that's how we find encouragement. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and 5 both tell us that we find encouragement and build each other up when we come together. What we can also do in that time is the fifth way that we can fuel that fire, and that is through service or ministry. If you're not finding a place to use your God-given gifts and abilities to honor Him and to serve others, then your spiritual flame is going to flicker and die out. You're certainly not going to spread it to anybody else. So keep fueling your fire through time with God and His people, because that not only helps ignite your own passion for God. Sometimes these disciplines are simply a matter of kind of stirring up our coals. Sometimes it's not a matter of me needing to put another log on the fire. Sometimes I just kind of need to poke it around a little bit and turn things over in order to get the fire burning a lot brighter. So in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6, Paul tells Timothy to fan into flame that gift that God had put within him. And that meant surrendering it to God and putting it to use, which we just talked about, using those gifts and abilities to honor God and to benefit others. So don't sit on those gifts. Don't bury them or hide them, but instead stir them up and let your passion burn bright so it touches others and inspires them to do the same. You know, King David is described by God himself as a man after God's own heart because he wasn't the type of guy who sat around and waited for somebody else to light his fire. In fact, in 1 Samuel chapter 36, it says when David was distressed and confronted with opposition on all sides that he strengthened or encouraged himself in the Lord. In other words, he didn't rely on other things or other people to inspire his faith or ignite his passion, but instead he took it upon himself to stir things up in his own soul. Now perhaps your passion for God, your desire to know him more and to pursue his purposes isn't burning quite as hot or bright as you would like right now. Maybe your flame seems to be barely flickering, but don't wait for another inspiring sermon or extraordinary life event or someone else to push you in the right direction. But instead, fan that flame of God in your own life by drawing closer to him, by letting him bring a little friction sometimes into your life, and keeping that fire fueled by spending time in God's word and prayer and in worship with others and fellowship and learning to serve others in a way that honors God. And if you're doing that, I believe he's going to stir up the flame in your life and it's going to be burning white hot and it's going to catch on to others around you. Now, that's just a little challenge in how we can get the fire of God going in our lives and keep it going. It all really comes down to staying close to God and letting his word and presence saturate and consume your life. But before I close, I want to quickly point out just a few precautions of how we might inadvertently let our fire die out if we're not careful. Now, this could be an entire sermon in itself, and this is where I kind of may revert to the old going so fast you can't keep up with me, but it's on video so you can go back and look. But I just want to hit a few things very quickly by way of precaution. You know, some of you may remember that song we used to sing as little kids about this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. And one of the verses of that says, I won't let Satan pff it out because I'm gonna let it shine. Well, if we're honest, I think there are times when we've probably let Satan pff out our flame, and there's any number of ways he tries to do that. I want to hit just a few of them before we're done, but one of the main things he'll try to do is to get our lives burning for another passion or with another fire other than God's. You know, when a people are trying to put out a forest fire that's out of control, one of the things they do is what's called a controlled burn. Well, they'll get ahead of the fire and light a wide path, and they'll let that burn out, and then they'll douse it, because when the big fire comes to that point, it can't burn something a second time. And that same principle can apply to our lives. If our passion is already burning for something else, it's going to be hard for God's fire to stay ignited in our lives. And one time I heard somebody say that whatever excites you the most will control you the most. So I want to challenge you to think about, is there anything that could incite you more than fulfilling God's purposes and being with him? I think if we're honest, there's probably a lot of things we get pretty excited about. If we have an opportunity to take a dream vacation, or you know, our friend comes and they got tickets to our favorite sports team, man, let's go. But you know, if it comes time to, hey, let's go to church tonight and do this or that, it's like, well, yeah, let me see, I'll think about it. And you know, maybe our passion gets stirred up a little easier for other things. And when that happens, we can be in danger of our fire for God really being doused. Another thing that happens is the devil just tries to douse and quench and put a blanket over our fire with any number of things. One of the things that can happen is just excess baggage in our lives, things that weigh us down or keep us from pursuing God's purposes effectively. In Jeremiah chapter 2, it says that God's people fell away from God because they followed worthless idols, and because of that, their lives became worthless themselves. In other words, they just became ineffective in fulfilling God's purposes because they started depending on other things besides God, and things begin to take God's place or take priority over him, or just certain things that God could have taken care of in their life, they were depending on other things. And Hebrews chapter 12 talks about laying aside those kind of sins and those kind of weights that can easily beset us and keep us from running that race effectively and running to win it. So don't let your time and energies get consumed by passions other than God. And that can include things like just bad habits can douse your flame. And that can include thoughts and actions. If there are certain things that we just dwell on and we keep coming back to those things, You know, to be honest, whatever we feed the most or exercise the most is going to be strongest. And the bottom line is if we spend more time feeding into things of our flesh or things that have troubled us in the past or things we just enjoy like our entertainment, and we take more time for things like that than putting our time and efforts into serving God's purposes, then we shouldn't be surprised at what part of our life is stronger or weaker. Romans chapter 6 talks about being dead to sin but alive unto Christ. And that doesn't happen by chance. We've got to let some of those old actions that we constantly feed into just begin to die off by not catering to those things or feeding those things, so that those things die off and we start feeding the things of God, and that's what becomes stronger in our lives. You know, bad relationships can quench that fire in our lives. You know, that's what God's people constantly were falling into, relationships that were pulling them away from Him. Attitudes can quench our fire. Philippians chapter 2:14 says, do everything without complaining or arguing. Man, there's few things that are going to quench your spiritual fire more in a body of believers faster than bad attitude. You talk about this virus being contagious. Bad attitudes are very contagious. And that kind of hits on the last thing I want to hit as we close. And that is any type of disunity with other believers in the church, or maybe you're harboring just unforgiveness toward one particular individual. But when those things are going on in our lives, that'll douse God's anointing and His revival. And in Romans chapter 16 and 1 Corinthians 1, it talks about being unified in purpose and love. Doesn't mean we agree on everything and every opinion or even every doctrine, but we're of the same mind and purpose, and we love one another. In Psalm chapter 133, it talks about the connection between God's blessing and anointing and unity among believers. And it basically tells us that if there's disunity going on, we're not going to have that anointing. We're not going to experience the revival fire of God in our presence when there's dissension or unforgiveness. So don't let those kind of things fester in your life. And I know that was a quick rundown of some of the things to be cautious of, but I just didn't want to leave you with things to get the fire going and you wonder sometimes, well, why isn't it going? There may be some of those things going on in your life, and we just need to rid ourselves of excess baggage or false idols or bad relationships or attitudes or disunity, unforgiveness, a lot of different things that can keep our fire burning bright for God, because we want that fire within us to burn as bright and hot as it can so it catches on to other people. So remember that. Stay close to God. Be in touch with Him through the word and prayer. Be in worship and fellowship with other people. Use your gifts to serve Him. Do those things that fuel that fire for God. Don't fuel and feed those things that keep taking you off in the wrong direction. You know what some of those things are in your life. Begin to cut those things loose and put your time and attention into other things that will begin to fuel that fire for God, so that your passion can burn hot and bright for Him. So as we close tonight, let me just pray with you and for you that God will keep that fire burning intensely in your life. Lord, I thank You that You have chosen to place Your presence, the fire of Your Spirit within our lives, and that's how You want it to spread throughout our community and around the world. And God, so I pray that that will happen. Lord, that there will be such a fire burning in us that it will be undeniable, unmistakable. God, let Your passions and purposes burn so bright in us that other people will just begin to see who You are and what You want to do, and it'll inspire them to want that kind of fire and passion in their lives as well. God, just keep us close to You, in direct contact with You, so that fire is constantly fueled. Let us go with that constant awareness of Your presence with us at all times, because we know what kind of a difference that'll make in our lives. Because, Lord, when we know, when we're walking close to You, when we're spending time with You, when our lives are saturated with Your presence, it's going to burn bright, and others are going to see. And, Lord, it is going to make a difference in the world around us. And that's what we want to do. God, use us in any way You choose. Start a fire, Lord, through us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a good week, and let God's fire burn bright in you.